meets with any liquor group, which is just outside the sanctuary on the side. Treats flowers to greeters, there was still a book in the back, that was to aid reader or provide treats or read the, do a scripture reading. Please take a moment and put your name in the book. It's nice to commemorate those day or whatever. We haven't had a lot of people signing up, so please do that. Announcements. I know. The NFL has the Lombardi Trophy. National Hockey League has the Stanley Cup. World Series has the Commissioner's Trophy for the World Series. This is our little baby. And next Sunday, this could, for a limited time, go home with you. Next Sunday is our chili cook-off, and this is our chili cook-off trophy. So, for those watching, for those that are here, this is a good point. Thank you very much. Other announcements, Thursday, February 21st is our family prayer night at 6:30 p.m. Don't forget that on Tuesdays, Pastor Andrew leads a Bible study. This time around is the book of Hebrews at 6:30. And Sunday mornings, of course, on a Bible study at 9:30. Are there any other announcements today? Okay. Seeing none, pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, in the book of Romans, Paul writes in chapter 5, verse 5, "But we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope." In the last week, you have made the scripture passage come alive for all of us, as you have given a snow shovel, water pipes to thaw, cars to start, and bitter cold to endure. He had to do it, and so we persevered. We had to get up the next day and do it all over again. There's our character. You gave us the hope that one more days were to come, and here we are. And you never take 19 degrees for granted anymore. You have shown us your amazing power in this world that you created. But you also held each of us that are here in the palm of your hand and helped us to get through it. May we take the lessons of this week to heart in our faith, that the trials that come to us every day to challenge our trust in you be met by perseverance to overcome them with the Holy Spirit and the fruits and gifts that he has given us. And because of that, may we have a stronger character in our trust in you and the hope of our salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the message we are about to receive. May we bless you with the words that are spoken and the hymns that are sung, as they are always meant to give you all the glory. May the Holy Spirit open our ears and minds to hear them and soften our hearts and let them be fertile ground for your message to be planted and bring forth an amazing harvest. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so can we please stand and sing our opening hymn today, which is "Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us," number 522, verses 1 and 2.
Thank you.
before we go into there, we're going to recite our Salem Church Covenant. This is the creed that binds us together. This is our common confession amongst each other. And if you don't have a hymnal, open your eyes, they're everywhere. If you don't have a hymnal, we also have the little banner up here that has it on there too. So if you would join with me, we'll say the Salem Church Covenant. We covenant with the Lord and one with another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God, and to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. So it's a fitting thing that we confess this covenant that we have together, as we are now entering into a time of celebrating another covenant, a covenant to end all covenants. This is the best thing that we have. This is the new covenant, which is cut with Christ's blood. And as we come to communion, it's a time of a solemn reflection, but also a time of rejoicing. And the solemn reflection comes from the examining why this covenant is needed to begin with. It's because we've been separated from God by our sin. And because of this, God being just has to mete out judgment and punish sin. And the question comes, how can God's people have this taken care of and not be consumed and destroyed by God's punishment? And the answer that God gives is sending his own son. Sin, all of our sin, is placed on Christ and paid in him. And so it's through his breaking of his body and the shedding of his blood that we are saved, that we are free from the guilt of sin. And we have been given the righteousness of Christ so that when we stand before God, we stand as perfect sons and daughters without blemish. And so when we come to this, we're going to have a time of reflection. And in this time, we confess to God that, you know, it is really not because of our own righteousness that we stand before this table. It's not. There's not any part of us that deserves to be there, but we're there because God is God. And you say, well, no, God's God. God is a merciful God. He is a God that gives mercy abundantly. He didn't even spare his own son. That is a merciful God. That God does not change. And so as we just recited our Salem covenant, we're going to use this time as another covenant renewal, another covenant reflection that we have that will never end, that's been bought with Christ's blood and will seal us for that day of redemption. So let's pray. We'll give us a couple moments here to have private prayer, and then we'll go into a public one, and then we'll distribute the elements. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you as a people, as a congregation that admits that we have come nowhere close to your standard. Lord, we are sinners in the worst way. And Lord, we don't like to say it that way, but that's the truth. But Lord, we know that even though you are so just and holy, that if we were to walk into the presence of you in a sinful state, that we would be consumed. Lord, you did not leave us to that state. Lord, you gave us your Son. Lord, you gave us your only Son who came and lived the perfect life for us. And instead of taking the reward, he through this that we come to the table. It's through this that we stand, in this life and in the next. So Lord, help us to remember what these elements mean. Help us to now enter into this joyous mode, Lord. That, Lord, you have paid for sin. You have given us a taste of what heaven is to come. It's a place of forgiveness, of complete guilt-freeness, a place where we can be with you. So, Lord, refresh us and help us to remember of your sacrifice and where we are going because of that sacrifice made for us. We pray this in Christ's name. Everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Let us now sing our communion hymn as the bread is passed out. That is 315, Break Thou the Bread of Life. Jesus' blood was shed for us. And with this cup, we remember.
Wow.
Well, I'm glad you're here. How are you guys this week? Good?
Great.
I was going to say, you probably had a couple days off from school.
Six.
Six? Ooh.
Six.
You would have to go.
Six and a half.
You would have to make those up when it's nice and sunny out. All right, well, today we have a kind of easing into our school. This is a lesson that Jesus gave to all his disciples. And look at all those people. This is Jesus the teacher. This comes from Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. It says, more and more people heard about Jesus. Soon great crowds came to hear him speak. They came from places near and from places far away. Jesus and his 12 disciples went up a mountain. Men and women and children followed them. Jesus sat on the side of the mountain, and the people sat below him. He had many lessons to teach them. Look at that. They're about to hear Jesus speak. Teach him. What does he say? It's kind of a cool little. And I know it looks old, doesn't it? God blesses all who depend on only him. They belong to the kingdom of heaven. God blesses all who feel sadness. They will find comfort. God blesses all who are humble, who do not boast and brag. The earth will belong to them. God blesses all who want to do right more than they want to eat or drink. They will be given what they want. God blesses all who show compassion and forgive. They will be treated with mercy. God blesses all whose hearts are pure. They will see him. God blesses all who will make peace. They will be called his children. God blesses all who are treated badly for doing right. They belong to the kingdom of heaven. I wonder if they're taking notes. So here's some other words. Treat others as you would want them to treat you. That is what the law and the prophets are all about. When you do good deeds, don't try to show them off. When you give to the poor, don't blow a loud horn. Then your gifts will be given in secret. I do that pretty well, huh? Your Father knows what is done in secret, and he will reward you. Asking you will receive, searching you will find, knocking the door will be opened for you. Everyone who asks will receive, everyone who searches will find, and the door will be opened for everyone who knocks. And then the last section here. Watch out for false prophets. They dress up like sheep, but instead they are wolves who have come to attack you. You can tell what they are by what they do. You are like a lamp or a light for the whole world. No one would light a lamp and put it under a clay pot. A lamp is placed where it can give light to everyone in the house. Make your light shine so that others will see the good you do and will praise your Father in heaven. So that is the end of that little teaching section. And of all that teaching, what stood out to you the most? What's something that you're going to try to incorporate into this week?
Jesus.
hole right there. So, they've already run off, so I'll come around and do it. You can pass your prayer requests and, oh, Ben, actually, no. Ben is eager. And as we do that, we're going to sing our prayer request, which is 6.2.
Following in the bulletin, posted scripture reading Romans 13:1-14. I apologize. I called an audible my scrimmage. For anyone who was wondering what happened this week, at this my heart pounds and leaps from his place. Listen to the roar of his voice, to the rumbling that comes from his mouth. He unleashes his lightning beneath the whole heaven and sends it to the ends of the earth. After that comes the sound of his roar. He thunders with his majestic voice. When his voice resounds, he holds nothing back. God's voice thunders in marvelous ways. He does great things beyond our understanding. He says to the snow, fall on the earth, and to the rain shower, be a mighty downpour. So that listen to this, Job. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God. From the book of Job, chapter 37, verses 1 through 14.
Foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly exhibited as crucified. The only thing I want to learn from you is this. Did you receive the Spirit from the works of the law, or by believing from what you had heard? Are you so foolish? Having started with the Spirit, are you now ending with the flesh? Did you experience so much for nothing? If it really was for nothing? Well then, does God supply you with the Spirit and the work and works miracles among you by you doing the works of the law, or by your believing from what you heard? Just as Abraham believed God and was reckoned to him as righteousness, so you see that all who believe are the descendants of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, declared the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the Gentiles should be blessed in you. For this reason, those who believe are blessed with Abraham who believes. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, I ask just for this time that you would open our hearts and our minds to your word, that, Lord, you would help me to be clear, concise, and most of all, faithful. Help me to lay out what your word says and help us all to be enriched by it. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So to start with, over the holidays, obviously this is going back to Christmas, we got together, we being Jenny and I, and her sister and brother-in-law, and we sit around the couch, and if you're not aware of the technology of video games these days, you have these little motion controls. And by what you do with the controls, it happens on the screen. So we're playing this game. We're all four of us in a raft. And I'm glad that we got this out of the way of what it would be like if we were all in a raft going down the river, because it's not, if anything by the game, it's not something that we should try. Because you all have to work together and row at the same time. So we all have to fling our little paddles, and we all, you know, looking like we're having fits and stuff, and try to get down and hit these balloons as we're going through. And so it looks kind of funny. And half the time, Jenny's sister, not half the time, but Jenny's sister once in a while look down, and it's like, hey, you're not rowing. And we see us like drifting into this sharp rock or something like that. And we're all like, pull up. And it got me thinking about something similar in our lives concerning when we drift in faith, that it
similar in our Christian life, if we're, say, in this little boat going down the river, that if we're not using our paddles, we can end up drifting where we don't want to go. We can drift into sharp rocks or all these different kinds of things. And this is kind of an analogous way of looking at what had happened in the church in Galatia, that these people had gotten into this drift, and they drifted more towards this false teaching that is quickly becoming a way of maybe shipwrecking the whole entire faith operation they have going on. And so what Paul does, as we've seen through his letter so far, is a strong letter of the defense of the gospel. And so that's what we're going to look at. Another section of how Paul makes that appeal in chapter 3. And so the main thing that we're going to take away from this morning is that Christians need to be aware of which way their little theological rulebook is going. And what we're going to do is have these two points that help keep us on track. The first is going to look at the danger of drifting into error, and the second is how to pull out and further guard ourselves from it. And so before going into these two points, we're first going to get a feel of the passage and get the lay of the land of it. And so, again, we start as a kind of a recap of where we've been. In the first two chapters of the book of Galatians, Paul has been making an argument from his experience. A heretical belief has slipped into the Galatian church. One that insists that to be considered righteous before God, one must trust in Christ and his death and resurrection, and observe circumcision rituals. The one in question being circumcision. Paul launches into offense of the true gospel message by writing this letter to the Galatian congregation. He's been giving an indirect appeal to the Galatian congregation, reminding them of his work as an apostle, his acceptance by the other apostles, and even his public correction of the apostle Peter, when Peter had begun to slip into separating from the Gentiles during meals. Paul is the real deal. His message that they had first heard and preached by him and his cohorts, ones that insist that one is made right before God based on Christ's work alone through faith, is the pure gospel. Deviation from this gospel, subtraction or addition to it, is a perversion of it. And now, as Paul finishes with his experiential appeal to the Galatians and the genuineness of his message, he then launches into a more direct appeal, a theological type argument. And this is where chapter 3 picks up. And so if we look at the text that we just read, we can see that we can divide it up into two little blocks. First block, verses 1 through 5, makes an argument from the Galatians' experience and their conversion. The second block, verses 6 through 9, is a reinforcing example of what Paul had just said by using the example of Abraham. And so when we read through the text here, in the first block, Paul's exasperation is palpable. He cannot believe that the Galatian believers are being swept up in this false teaching. He tells them that they've had Christ so vividly talk to them, and for that reason, to now stray is akin to being under a spell of some sort. A spell that makes your spiritual discernment go to zero, apparently. He questions them about how the Spirit was received by them. How were they converted? How did they enjoy the charismatic gifts? Was it because they kept the law? Or was it because they heard the message of the gospel and responded in faith? The answer is obviously the latter. But the rhetorical question helps add this kind of loving sting to the rebuke. They started with the Spirit. Are they now going to go back and be perfected by the law, by the flesh? Are they going to pour new wine into old wineskins, as has been said by Christ? And what of Abraham? How was he considered righteous before God? In block 2, Paul points to the great patriarch and tells them that Abraham, before the law was even given, was considered righteous before God. How? By faith. Abraham trusted God and it was counted to him
And those who have faith like Abraham are the true descendants of Abraham. Not only the ones who are physical descendants or ones who keep the law. The gospel is preached beforehand to Abraham. You may say, how is that so? Well, it was preached to Abraham because just as Abraham, a Gentile, was considered righteous because of his trust in God, so too will all the Gentiles, as well as the physical descendants of Abraham, be considered righteous before God because of their trust in God. And how does one trust God? By believing the one whom the Father has sent. Similarly said in John 6. And so now for our points here. So a Christian needs to be aware of which way their theological boat is going by knowing the danger of drifting into error. First point, by knowing the danger of drifting into error. And so, look at verse 1. Just within verse 1, you can kind of see Paul's attitude of where this is going. He doesn't say, oh, bless your hearts, you're a little off. It's okay. He says, you fools! You foolish Galatians! Who has bewitched you? Bewitched. He didn't, put them in front of the TV and go, watch Bewitched. The show. But this bewitched is kind of a drawing on of a thing of back then they thought of the evil eye, that people can kind of give you the stink eye and bad things will happen. And so it's not that Paul is saying that someone has actually put them under a spell, but he's saying that what you are doing after Christ has been so publicly portrayed to you as crucified, that Christ has been so vividly portrayed to them in a way that to now go back to what they're doing, they must have a spell on them. Nobody is that stupid. Surely. But yet here Paul is saying, oh man, you took a hard turn. So this is the feel we get for where these people are going if they continue along the way that they go. Kind of a similar example of the kind of exasperation one might feel. And it's funny because this example that includes Drew is actually a positive one of him. He's not here. So, well. But Drew has this hobby of going around and would take pictures. He takes pictures. I come along and just drive the car. But we go in different places, and he takes pictures in abandoned places or in the woods, and we find these real cool things. And a lot of times, it's kind of treacherous out there. And every time we bring Jenny is our sees the full danger picture of what we do sometimes and lets us know. So we do something, and she's, on the other side of the creek going, why would you do that? What are you doing? Stop. Don't do that. You guys are going to break something, or you're going to get wet or something. And it's not like we're throwing glass at each other or something like that. But it's kind of normal things you would come across in hiking or something like that. But she has this exasperation that this is the full gravity of the situation that we're in and the potential danger that come out of it. And so, and Drew and I were kind of oblivious. We know how to jump over this, or we know how to do this. And so we're kind of, it's not too bad. But Jenny knows the actual danger of the situation. And some of us, some of you, may have that kind of casual attitude that Drew and I have, but only towards your faith. Dangerous attitude to have. More dangerous than bodily harm. Bodily harm can only kill you once. That doesn't make Jenny feel any better. We only die once, Jenny. Spiritual harm can kill you twice.
spiritual harm can kill you twice. You don't have any idea what that's referencing to. You've been in church for most of your life. Let that be the cue for Paul's words in verse 1 to hit you in the forehead. Point 2. Spicy, I know. Mm-hmm. The way one paddles out of error and stays out of error is by knowing God's word. One of my favorite teachers up at the school I got, went to, Dr. Carson, he says it this way, that people don't, when it comes to people don't drift towards holiness. So when we let things go, let things drift, let us be taken in by currents of the day, whether they be in the culture or whether they've been in the church, and they let us go, you know, kind of each way, we don't drift towards the good things, we drift towards the rocks. We end up hitting stuff, and it's not good. It hurts. Going back to the example of the boat, which I've already done. If you do not maneuver and propel your boat with the paddles it came with, you're going to end up drifting in a direction you don't want to go. Or you may get caught up in a current that you don't want to be in. If you think that you can do the Christian life without using paddles that were provided, in this case, the Bible, God's word, then you will drift into error. Thus, if we find ourselves in this downward drift, or we want to continue on the straight and narrow, we turn to the text. Use those as the paddles. Don't actually stick the Bible in the water, though if you're so inclined to, they make waterproof Bibles now. But, how does this look? So, the problem in the text here, we have believers that are carried away by this false teaching, or are being disturbed by it. Faith plus works makes us righteous before God. That's the bad part. That's not me saying that. So what is the remedy? What does Paul do? He takes them to the text. He goes and points them to say, is this teaching that you're being fed true? He points to Abraham, verses 6 and 9. He says, look at Abraham. Before the law had come about, Abraham was declared righteous. So Abraham was declared righteous before circumcision was even given, which is the condition that the people say you must be in to be considered righteous before God. If that is true, how is Abraham being made righteous before God? And he says it's because of his faith. It's his faith that's made him righteous. Therefore, it's by faith that righteousness is accredited to us. What Paul had originally said in the gospel. And just a quick thing about faith, just to describe Abraham's faith here. Faith has a mental assent to it, but it's not merely mental assent. Romans 4. You turn to Romans 4, 21 and 22. Being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteous. Let's talk about Abraham. Abraham's faith was a mental assent that God, yes, God can do it, but that his faith propelled his actions to be in accordance with that affirmation. His faith and character, or his actions and his character, were determined by that faith. And then, kind of going backwards with the experience, Paul points to their own experience and says, okay, you, in your experience, you've received the Spirit, you've received the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit. How did you receive that? Who, you know, if you put it up to a comparison, is it like Abraham's experience, where you believed and you experienced these things that you heard? Or did you do these works of the law and then get them? And obviously the answer is, well, it's by hearing and believing
yours and Abraham's are the same. Experience. And so through this, we have kind of a straight to the heart refutation of what these people are bringing about. And not only does this give us more knowledge of God and His Word, but it also brings us into a closer connection with Him. It brings us into a more close walk with Him. We know that when we are faced with troubles by life, where do we turn? We turn to God. We turn to His Word, and we seek out comfort there. There's a good Snoopy cartoon. I know it's Linus. I forgot the other one because I was going to look it up. But we have two of the peanuts here. Here's one of them, Linus. And it's raining. Really raining hard. And one of them says, oh man, I hope the place doesn't flood and we all get washed away. Linus goes, well, the Bible says that God said He's never going to destroy us through a flood again, so it's not going to get that bad. And the other peanut character goes, oh, that's a relief. And Linus reports that good theology as a way of doing that. So I thought that was pretty good. But it's taking comfort in who God is and who He's revealed Himself to be. That's what God's Word does. It directs us. It binds our wounds. It illuminates our dark world and gives us hope moving forward in the Christian journey. It informs us how God's gracious and loving character. Think back, how did Jesus resist the devil and the temptations when He was tested in the wilderness? Scripture.
Yeah.
How do we respond if someone came to us and just suggested the same way of using our flesh to finish what the Spirit has started? Might we go to Philippians 1:6. Let's turn there real quick. Philippians 1:6 says, I'm confident that this, the one who began a good work among you, will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. What God has started, He is going to finish. Or how about Hebrews 7:25? Consequently, He is able for all time to save those who approach God through Him, since He always lives to make intercession for them. He is able to save to the uttermost. So to conclude, I'll leave with these two thoughts here. The first is to clarify that while the Bible has strong rebukes and warnings in it, for believers they are meant for edification and shaping us into the people God is making us to be in Christ. As believers, we have passed from death to life because of Christ's work. By faith, which is a gift from God, we cling to Christ as our only hope in this life and the next. He is able to save to the uttermost. And His work at the cross is sufficient to pay for our sins. And His righteousness imputed to us is able to make us stand before a holy and perfect God when we eventually come to that place. The second thought is more of a, I don't want to end on a downer, but it's not really a downer. But it's a kind of a common kind of struggle one feels if you've ever tried to explain Christian teaching to someone. And this comes from this is a little devotional book, but it breaks up his writings. And if anybody knows, Luther, how he has almost this, at first glance, like a strong hatred for the law, like, no, don't do it, kind of thing. We want to keep faith and work separate. However, again, Luther's a real textual type guy. You have to know what thing he's addressing. And while it is true that we are saved by faith because of Christ's grace through His work at the cross, that because we've been saved into a new life that produces these fruits and these works. So this is what he said. He says, there are two parts of Christian teaching that we must emphasize
for the Christian daily. Neither faith nor works can be ignored. For when faith isn't preached, when no one explains how we are joined to Christ and become branches in him, then everyone resorts to their own works. On the other hand, if we teach only about faith, it leads to false Christians. These people praise faith, but are baptized and even call themselves Christians, but they don't show any fruit or power. That's why it is so difficult to preach. Someone always goes off on a tangent. If I don't preach about faith, the results will be useless and hypocritical works. If I only emphasize faith, no one does any good works. The result is either useless, faithless do-gooders or believers who don't do any good works. He had a lot of struggle with this with the people at the time. So we must preach the message to those who accept both faith and works. We must preach to those who want to remain in the vine, to put their trust in Christ, and to put their faith into action in their everyday lives. We have been saved to live for Christ. And we can't do this without his power. So let's pray that he would help us to do that, to live out our faith this week. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this message. Lord, we thank you that through strong rebukes you also bind us up. You leave us with examples of your grace. And Lord, we want to reflect, Lord, that the way we are accepted by you is by reaching out and receiving with faith what you have already done for us. Lord, there is nothing intrinsically good in us that helps us be acceptable before you.